extensibility of Anupam Ji's writings?
Obviously, when you grow up in that kind of an environment, you have a sharp sensibility for language. And because he grew up in an environment of Indian languages, his sensibility was for Indian languages. Given that his father had turned the literary craft into an everyday thing, he grew up with that sense that writing is about making sense to another human being. That's what it is. So he was very wary of anything written that's overly ambitious, beyond making sense to another person. And Ram pointed it out earlier that that's part of the old Gandhian legacy, because Gandhi was also about this. You know, he wrote to make sense to another person. The thing with Anupam Ji is he didn't stray from that. And many people have written pieces praising his literary style, saying, and big names in the Hindi literary world. Every now and then he'd get a piece which was praising his writing. And what I didn't say about him is he was a ruthless editor. He could be so severe, you wouldn't think he was the same gentle, soft-spoken person. And he'd read a piece and say, "Dekho, वैसे तो अपनी तारीफ में लिखा है, लेकिन कैसी भाषा इस्तेमाल की है?" And then he used a wonderful metaphor to seal the point. He said, "You know, it's so easy to walk on your legs. Why do so many people try to walk on their hands? You know, why? Write simple stuff, figure it out." The other thing that he stressed was good writing is clear. And clarity in writing comes from clarity of thought. The words he used was, agar vichar saaf hai, to bhasha kharaab bhi ho, to dheere dheere saaf ho jati hai. Lekin vichar ka saaf hona zaruri hai. Man saaf hona chahiye, jo aap, to bhasha apne aap dheere dheere theek ho. And the number of journalists who'll tell you that they were ticked off about language by him. You know how minute he could get. There's a Hindi television journalist, Ravish Kumar. Many of you must have heard of him. He got a letter from Anupam Ji one day telling him that when you're addressing people in Hindi and when you say mitro, it doesn't have an anuswar. It's not mitron. When you're saying mere mitron ke saath kahin gaya tha, then it's okay. Then you can say mitron. But when you're addressing them, the old Hindi kaida is you say mitro without the anuswar. Now, I spent 15 years working in English, but I always knew that when I wanted to do my work, I'll do it in Hindi. So I started working with him. And I often had questions because I'd not worked extensively in Hindi before that. So I'd have questions, how do I sort this out? How do I approach this? Do I use this word or do I use that word? And that often used to degenerate into very long conversations on language, which had nothing to do with the problem at hand, but it was beautiful because, you know, I dealt with him closely and he managed to keep it from me that he actually knew the grammar very well. He studied Sanskrit. He was going to do his PhD in Sanskrit. But nobody got a sense that he knew so much Sanskrit. He was actually classically trained, as Ram mentioned in his speech. But he didn't show it at all. And when you had language questions, he did not answer those questions with grammar. He answered them with practice. And he'd say, iska kaida ye hai. Isko karne ka tarika ye hai. And often he'd leave you with a thought and say that, forget about it, we'll talk about it later. And then after a while, you'd realize, oh, this is what he said. And he'd leave it to you saying, okay, you don't see it right now. You'll see it later. But he was very, very averse to giving a theory. No theory. Because if you respect everything, how can you give a theory? You know, one of the nicest essays on writing in English is by George Orwell, Politics in the English Language. And he has 6 rules there. He gives 5 rules, and the 6th rule is, break any of these rules sooner than say something outright barbarous. That was Anupamji. You know, he'd break any rule. And it was, rules were only meant to help. So he, I think his writing becomes all the more important in Hindi because of the steady degeneration of Hindi writing otherwise. You know, the quality of Hindi that we get in newspapers around us is so bad that anybody who refuses to lower their standards, you know, as Vishwanath said, stands out. You know, anybody who's just, you know, content writing in a way that is nothing more than making sense to another person stands out, because that's gone so out of fashion. Does that answer your question? Yeah.
I have a question about him that you said many times that he was leading a very simple life. So what does the mean of simple life here, and what was his own perspective and how he came to that perspective in his life?
Okay, I'll give you a couple of personal examples. I was always interested in buying comfortable footwear for him. And many years of efforts, I could never buy it. Because he insisted on buying cheap footwear. Now slowly, he had a particular brand of Bata slippers that he wore all the time. Except in winters when he wore cloth shoes. Now, that is the cheapest slipper, formal slipper, leather slipper that Bata has. And many of the stores have stopped selling those. So there were all these expeditions to take a bus and go to a cheaper locality, you know, where they'll have ordinary Bata shops where you'll buy those sandals for 200 rupees. Now, always traveled by bus, which meant, you know, many years ago I'd read it in a BBC journalism manual that if you hope to be a journalist, make sure you use public transport because you'll get a lot of story ideas. Anupamji always used public transport, and he turned that into a strength. He has some of the most wonderful pieces on DTC buses. And he had this lovely piece where he described how DTC, how the bus stops in Delhi have changed over the years. Because he noticed them, because he used them. Now, because you're not in a hurry, you don't want to make it big, you don't take on work that distracts you too much. That also means you can slowly do what you want to do. Your costs are low. He was actually very worried about money, because the most important lesson he said he learned was from a man called Banwarilal Chaudhary, who was an agriculture scientist who refused to join the Gandhian movement because his family had taken a loan to educate him. And who told Gandhiji that the day I repay my family loan, I'll come and join you. And he did. The day the loan was repaid, he went to Wardha. He was the man behind Mitti Bachao Andolan. And he told Anupamji that having too many resources doesn't ensure quality of work. In fact, having resources is often a problem. Right? He learned this in 1974 from Banwarilal Chaudhary, which meant every time somebody tried, like, you know, you heard from Vishwanath, it was not easy to give him money. In fact, it was nearly impossible. But if you had the resources and you maintained a relationship, then he always found a good way for you to spend your money well. Because he always used to cultivate people who were capable of doing well and who didn't have resources. And when the right time came, he'd call this guy with the money, this guy with the ability, and say, why don't you have tea together? And he did it all the time. So lack of resources became an instrument of ensuring quality for him. So you live cheap, you know, eliminate what you don't need, declutter, very valuable books. He'd use them, he'd read them for a while, get his research, take his notes. Then he'll look for a candidate who might enjoy it and give it to them. The word for this in Hindi is aparigra. It's one of the 11 vows that Gandhi spoke of, aparigra. Lots of it, he had it. Anything good, a nice lens here, you take it.
So after this listening, I had two more things. First thing that many people are here in India, maybe by their own choice or not, they are following with the cheap things because they are poor. They don't have so much budget for the branded things. And the second, when I went for the immersion, for my ITR immersion, there I got some people, those who were saying that if I purchase something branded thing, then people ask me that how can you work in the social work, social area? Because you are wearing branded things, that means you are wasting your money. Means how these things correlated with each other. Means branded things means they are more reliable, they will be with us for many years. It can also be a reason to purchase any branded thing. But this is not a reason that why, if I am working in a social area, I cannot purchase the brand thing.
It's a peculiar problem in India's social service sector. A very simple answer to that. What is it about? Is it about aesthetics or is it about your image? The moment you can remember that, it clears up the confusion. If it's about aesthetics, if you need to use a brand, use it. If it's about image, then the brand becomes more important than the utility. This is what he'd say, I'm pretty sure.
So I wish you would respond to what Vishwanath was sort of saying about people like Anupam Mishra and Gandhi doing a disservice. Because kabhi kabhi mujhe bhi bahut gussa aata hai Gandhi pe. You know, I'm like, why did he have to show us all this? Mar jate, you know, waste crisis, water crisis. You know, nahi hota kuch. Why did he have to show us alternatives and push us into being these extraordinary sort of individuals, you know? I mean, we are ordinary people, you know? So why do you have to have be this beacon? So you know, he's sort of like, I mean, pokingly sort of, you know, saying something about it. So I wish you both would respond to that.
Okay. I think he was saying it partly in jest. You know, there's a difference between Gandhi, who set impossible standards, and of course broke his own son in the course of that. But people, I think Vishwanath is saying what he did in jest. His work is better and richer. It would have been good and rich anyway, but it's better and richer for having met Anupamji, right? Likewise with Sopan, right? Likewise, so I think these are people who, you know, who's, as Sopan said, whose influence is imperceptible. You know, obviously, you can't live up to them. Obviously, you feel that, you know, they are quite extraordinary. But meeting them makes you less flawed, more focused, clearer about what you want to do, what you can do, what you cannot do. You know, I didn't know Anupam well. I'll just share one personal memory of Anupam because it's linked to the last, question. I knew him, I mean, I respected him, I knew him, but it was more through people. When he was dying, Sopan said, come and see him. And he was dying of cancer, and he said, you come. And I went, I mean, I felt embarrassed. But you know, when I saw him there, and it's linked to your question, you know, often you say when people have a terminal illness, they're stoic. You know, they're like tough. But I don't know what the word, I mean, even though I write in English and think in English, and I think I write fairly good English, I can't think of a word to describe Anupam that day. Not stoic. Content, at peace, calm, you know, and he wanted to chat with me. We were conversing happily, and we were talking about Chandi Prasad ji, and at some stage, you know, because Garhwal came up, and Kumau came up, and he said, a mutual friend, an extraordinary Uttarakhandi historian, Shekhar Pathak, his name came up. I said, Shekhar, see, baat karwaye? And he said, karwa, karwa. And then here is a man dying, you know, and absolutely terribly ill. And he had Shekhar chatted for 8 or 10 minutes, and, you know, Sopan and me looking around. So there's that kind of, you know, I said, the English language doesn't have words. You can say steely, you can say stoic, you can say detached, but they don't capture it. You know, and I think that is what people like him give us. You know, so I think, of course, we are much more flawed. So I think he was saying it in jest. You know, but let him answer for himself.
Well, it's not jest, actually. I'm sorry, Ram, I disagree with you. So. No, I remember incidences, and I'll tell you one of them. I was with Chhatar Singh in Barmer and in Jaisalmer, and we were looking at the Rajasthan Canal, the Indira Gandhi Nehar, one of the branches, full of sand. And I started to have a conversation with Chhatar on the canal itself. He had done a lot of work on it, and he'd understood also the local resources. But Chhatar started to cry when he saw the promise of that development, what it did to the village and the villagers who had promised water and had, you know, invested a lot of money, invested a lot of hope on that canal water coming, and it didn't come for 30 years. You see, these are difficult things to narrate, but if you write about a time when the state was not so big, when India was not urbanized, when there was a particular framework of governance, a samaj running a system of water, of rainwater harvesting, of lakes and talabs. But now you're in a time when things have changed. But your description of those times themselves bring a romance to it, right? And you want that in your life, in your current life now. You want something positive to see. And you see many an attempt by governments, by NGOs, by academics to try and rectify the situation, to try to make resources common pool or to make it community organized. And time and again you fail. And Ram was reading out the litany of woos around water, right? This is in spite of us knowing the traditional wisdom, knowing all what was local and what was happening. So I think there's a profound sense of disturbance that one has in the mind. It's not a comfortable feeling. And if you're engaged with it, and if you're sensitive enough, it really bothers you. Because then the question comes, what do you teach others? What do you want your children to learn? What do you want your students to learn? Should they deal with the practical, or should they deal with the impossible? Should you sell them dreams, or should you sell them reality? And this is very it's a very tough one to answer. Because you will always find the one in thousand, one in million who will pick the Anupam way. But what about the rest, the million minus one? What is it that we promise? A Mihir Shah is in his own ideal state. He is carried away by the reforms of the Central Water Commission and the Central Groundwater Board. These entrenched forces and these forms, the way I see it, are completely impossible to change. A Madhav Gadgil committee report is a beautiful document, but it's impossible to implement. Even a Kasturi Rangan report is impossible to implement. What then the use of these reports? I ask myself, should you invest in these ideal state scenarios or not? So I wish I had jested. I don't jest. I think this is a profound question, and this is what I think would have been very interesting to see, to hear more from Anupam's perspective on what he thought about it. Because even in his last meeting, when he came to the Rivers Network conference, and he spoke in that bad health, ill health, he spoke very sarcastically in his typical way, very understated sarcasm, very biting, critiquing the government's efforts to clean the Ganga. But then it was still sarcasm. There was still no path to reform the system. There was still no path to clean the Ganga. So if we are engaged in Sisyphean tasks, what strength do we draw from our masters and from our philosophers? I ask. I don't know.
Let me answer. Because I asked him. First thing that he'd say to that, I've had many conversations on this. And see, publicly, he had a certain manner. But how did he resolve it for himself? So he turned around and said, "Dekho, apne ko kisi ne dunia ko bachane ka theka nahi diya." You know, nobody's entrusted us to save the world. Nobody gave me an appointment letter to say, what are you going to do to the rest of the world? I am doing what I can figure out, right? And the rest is, you know, people will do as it comes. One, and he'd say, but we have to slowly raise the water level, not just the groundwater level, but slowly raise our level. And that happens very slowly, but it does happen. And it happens, to me, the greatest sample of poetry which is used in his book also, is by Tulsidas when he's describing in Kishkindha Kand, there's a little passage where he uses the rain metaphor to explain people and says, if it's a shallow river and it gets water, it'll break it, its banks and cause floods. You know, and if it's samiti samiti jal bharahi talaba, jimi sadguna sajjana pahiyava. You know, a water body gets water drop by drop by drop. And if you wish to be that water body, you will be that water body. Right? And it's a, see, he was very wary, like I said earlier, he was very wary of giving blanket solutions. He was, he never used the word policy. Never. I mean, if he used the word policy, it was in a very subversive way. It's a niti aniti. Niti ke saath aniti bhi judi hui hai. But have, and he said, giravat ka daur hai, toh cheezein bigdengi. Lekin achhi baatein karne ka mauka hamesha hota hai. For example, what, you know, as Ram described just now about Chandi Prasad ji, they were facing terrible odds. But they decided to take a risk with something nice. And that spread. Likewise, Anupam ji saw something nice. He met a nice, wise old man who told him a few things. He thought it's worth taking to another person. And that's, he said, ye karlo to bahut hai. Isse dheere dheere apna groundwater level badhta hai. Ek ek boond se. One. Second, you asked about how do we see it. Now, if we want to be somebody else, that by itself is dishonest. You know, I have no desire to be anybody else other than myself. You know, warts and all. That doesn't even figure. So, but there are a lot of valuable things that you, that we can pick up from all these people. And see, what becomes successful and what doesn't is never in our hands. It's in the hands of things which are much bigger than us. Some things become successful, some things don't. Who knows, there might have been comparable people who didn't become this famous. But it is up to us to do what we can. That itself is a motive big enough to do what we think is the right thing to do. Right? And the third is my favorite anecdote of Anupam ji, which helps explain a lot of things. I've grown up in a family where we weren't taught to say thank you. Right? It was awkward to adjust to my mother sitting here. You know, we didn't say thank you when somebody gave us something. Because it was assumed that we exist because of other people. A part of them is in us. A part of us is in them. Whatever we get is a gift. So I got into an argument with a highly learned friend over the right thing to do to express gratitude. And I was saying, okay, fine, you know, as after I've grown up, I've learned to say dhanyavad, shukriya, thank you, and all of these things. I never feel comfortable with this. But he said, nahi, meherbani to keh sakte hain. Then the old problem between Persian and in Sanskrit and Hindi, and it went in that direction, as these conversations do. And then he said, nahi, lekin shishtachar kya hai? So I said, listen, this is courtly culture, where, you know, where there's a decorum and this, that. I didn't grow up in a courtly culture. I grew up in a very ordinary culture where you assume that you exist because of other people's generosity. And you remember that. You don't forget that. So he said, nahi, nahi, aise nahi hota. You have to acknowledge somebody's kind act. So shishtachar kya hai? What is shishtachar? So I said, you know, my answers were unconvincing. So he said, go and ask Anupam ji. Right? In the way these things go and ask an older person. So I went and asked Anupam ji. He said, dekho, shishtachar kuch nahi hai. Shisht logon ka acharan hi shishtachar. People who are civil, people who are, you know, who are concerned about other people, how they behave is the code of conduct. There's no rule book to say, ye shishtachar hai. If I bow to you 18 times, I am shisht. I might be carrying a knife.
Or a Beretta revolver, actually.
Or a Beretta revolver. But this is the first part of what he says. So I said, then how does the other person understand that you're grateful? He said, you know, if you're grateful, you can't hide it. It shows in your eyes. And I've heard this from many people, among them, I mean, Chatur Singh talks like this. You know, if you're grateful towards another human being, that person will know. They'll know it from your conduct, from the look in your eye. And we have to trust our motive. We have to trust that the other person understands. Because if we don't trust, then we are on a slippery slope. We have to build on that trust that we can, that the other person can see that we have been the recipient of other people's civility. And so we channel it forward. Does that make sense? Okay.
As someone who did know him well, who listened to him and read it, there's a complaint I would make of him. I never dared say it to him, and Sopan may have asked it, by the way. And that is, why did he, how many years have heard his TED talk? I'll tell you, it's better than any talk any of us in this room have ever given. It's fabulous, and it was given in the English language. And if I have a complaint against Anupam, it would be this. Why did he not speak more in English? I can't ask him that question. But I've asked other people that question. My friend to the left is one. I think he's learned it. I think he'll operate in two languages. There's an extraordinary Tamil historian called A.R. Venkatachalapathy, who's a very close friend of mine, and has now started writing more in English. I knew a person like Anupam, who's a scholar, and only a scholar. He's still around, and he'll be unknown to everyone in this room except possibly Venu, who's a great Bengali historian called Gautam Bhadra, who's written 18 books in Bangla and 2 essays in English. And his English was as flawless as Anupam's, but he said, I will not write in English. Gautam Bhadra was, in his youth was a Maoist, so English for him was an imperialist language. I don't know what Anupam's take on that would have been. But I think this would be my, you see, because those who have the facility to be bilingual or trilingual. Rajaji famously said, when Lohia tried to impose Hindi on South India, because English was a foreign language, Rajaji said that Saraswati is the goddess of language, so she gave birth to all languages, including English. So English is an Indian language, right? Now, and of course, he wrote a great deal in Tamil, too. And I think those who have the facility, I mean, Sopan is one, and I'm glad he writes in both languages. I mean, the very gifted Gandhian scholar, Tridip Surud, is another. Anupam could easily have talked in English. You know, there may be other reasons to this. I posed this question to a mutual friend, not Sopan, somebody else who knew an older person, who said that, you know, it may have been. This was his explanation. This is actually Gopal Gandhi. And I asked Gopal Gandhi, who actually writes in several languages. Gopal Gandhi himself writes in, you know, has translated from Gujarati, from Hindi, has written in English, speaks in Tamil. I asked him this question.
There is rumor he knows Klingon.
Huh?
There is rumor he knows Klingon also.
Okay. So I asked Gopal, why do you think Anupam never wrote in English? I didn't know Anupam well enough. He said, this could be the reason. He said, one reason could be that he was his father's son. His father being such a great writer, you know, he had to take more care of his Hindi. Secondly, if he wanted to inhabit that world completely, you know, the world of, which is also the world of the peasants and the pastoralists and the water harvesters, he spoke and lived, right? He had the nuances, he had to master it completely, so he didn't want to be distracted. But, you know, if Sopan has an answer, that would have been a question I wanted to ask him but never dared. You know, given that TED talk, why could he give a few more talks in English?
People who persuaded him to give that talk, they should be interviewed. Because I think they had to try incredibly hard. And there are not too many people who could try that hard. He was a reluctant man, Anupamji. And if he were to say something, if he had to write something, he needed to prepare for it. He had to be ready. And he believed that language is a very instinctive thing. He's, and you make choices and there are costs. So if you do go for scope, then your quality gets compromised in terms of language, in terms of ideas. And if you're interested in studying desi stuff, it's almost like, you know, I can say you're a historian. Why don't you deal with physics? Because it requires expertise. The amount of time you spend with your material.
But you know, give an offer, he can't refuse.
No, but my point is, where I want to refute that is the people. I mean, he knew Gandhi wrote in three languages.
No,
I mean, so it's not either or. For those who are, I can understand Chandi Basaji wanting, but I think Anupam's English was good enough for
you know,
him to occasionally, not to you know, trade one for another. That's not, of course, not what I'm asking for at all.
There's a second part to this, and then there is another point. The second part to this is, see, we think of him as a very famous person now, as a celebrity. For the longest time in his life, nobody bothered to look at Anupam Mishra. Very few people considered him anything because he, first of all, he effaced his successes himself. He believed in, log paap dhone jaate hain, apne ko apne punya bhi dho dene chahiye. He said this several times. कि पुण्य भी धो देने चाहिए लोग विफलता से भागते हैं अपने को सफलता से भी भागना चाहिए he'd keep on saying all these things so he was very content where he was and then suddenly he was hit by all this fame came and literally smacked him right in the middle of his face he had no idea he had become this famous you know that all these people wanted to spend time with him they thought that he had this wisdom because among his peers he was this very ordinary person He was committed to a certain kind of ordinariness. So his fame in the last few years was actually a surprise for him as well. And he turned around and said, you know, people complain that they don't get what they deserve. I have a complaint that I'm getting much more than I deserved. You know, there are all kinds of people who say all kinds of nice things to me and, you know, say this is like Bhagavad Gita and that is like Bhagavad Gita. Arey yaar, I wrote it because I needed to. Right? So he used to tone that down. But there's another reason. And this bilingual question, I know because, see, his prose follows a lot from my father. He said this publicly, that his prose was influenced, was formed by Prabhash Joshi. Now, he also worked in English for a while, but then moved out of English and did nothing in English after he started working in Hindi. Because you have to make a choice. And the advantage that these people had is, they had other people who worked in English. So if you need this, ask this person. He knows the same thing. He'll do it in English. And his English is better than mine.
But he didn't know the same thing. I'm not sure that...
No, so he could lay it out because he was an open source man. Everything about him was open source. So it was right there. You wanted anything, here it is. And at least 10 or 15 years, actually even more, almost 18 years, I've been doing his English stuff like an assistant, right? So he said, I try to do this in English. You'd be able to do it better than me. I'll tell you what to write. Write it down in English. Because he also believed in a certain kind of collaboration, that you become much better and bigger when you collaborate. When people with, so daira, you know, I mentioned daira earlier. He used to say, ye apna daira hai. Is daire ke apan aadmi. Tumhara daira kuch aur hai. तो ये दोनों चीजें मिला लें तो हम दोनों अपने दायरे से उठ जाएंगे इफ यू नो सम इंग्लिश एंड यू आई नो सम आई हैव सम मटेरियल यू कन्वर्ट दैट इन इंग्लिश यू गेट बेटर देन योर इंग्लिश स्किल्स आई गेट बेटर देन माय नॉलेज स्किल्स यू नो सो इट वाज सो ही नेवर सॉ इट एज अ प्रॉब्लम ही
evangelical about the kind of ideas that he had. I mean, and so maybe he didn't feel as strongly as many of us who are comfortable in the English language, in that linguistic ecosystem,
that he didn't feel necessary to inhabit that also, because he was already embedded in a certain, you know, linguistic culture that he was part of and the people that were all linked to it. So he didn't feel that kind of urgency or the necessity to now, you know, encompass a much larger world in that. I was wondering if you had, if you would agree with that or...
It was just, see, he used to prepare a lot for everything. You don't get this kind of quality without that distillation. Doing that in English was a great cost to him. So it's it was just a question of cost. It was not a, I don't think it was a terrible ideological thing. Nothing about him was terribly ideological. It was a practical thing. Ye karein ya wo karein? I used to, I'll quote him. Yahan baith ke clerk hi karenge ya is sab mein time gawayenge?
सोपान ने शायद नहीं बोला जो मुझे याद दिलाता है उनके पिताजी की एक कविता थी जिसमें पिताजी जो हिंदी के इतने कवि थे लोगों की भाषा में बोलने वाले कवि वो अपने पाठक को अपने सामने खड़ा करके अपने पाठक की बात कर रहे थे अपनी बात करने से ज़्यादा क्योंकि भवानी प्रसाद मिश्र के पाठक उसकी कविता की जो पंक्ति है उसमें बोलते हैं कि जिस तरह तू बोलता है उस तरह तू लिख फिर भी मुझसे बड़ा तू दिख आगे की पंक्तियाँ शायद सोपान बताएंगे और फिर बोलेंगे अनुपम भाई पे उस कविता का कितना प्रभाव था और उसकी लेखनी में वो पिताजी की जो कविता है उसने क्या क्या
अभी 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 टेकिंग टू मच टाइम बिकॉज इट्स अ ब्यूटिफुल थिंग इट्स नॉट जस्ट अबाउट लैंग्वेज It's about writing as well, that poem. I consider it my... Vishwanath was talking about standards, na? So I consider that poem a standard of language. And it is... Kalam apni saad aur man ki baat bilkul theek hai ekad. Ekad, not too much. Ya ki teri bhar na ho to likh. और बहते बने सादे ढंग से यह कि तेरी भर न हो तो लिख और बहते बने सादे ढंग से यह कि तेरी भर न हो तो कह और सादे ढंग से बहते बने तो बह जिस तरह हम बोलते हैं उस तरह तू लिख और उसके बाद भी हमसे बड़ा तू दिख बीज ऐसा बो कि जिसकी बेल बन बढ़ जाए बात ऐसी कह कि जिसका स्वाद सिर चढ़ जाए फूल फल लगे ऐसे कि सुखरस सार और समर्थ प्राण संचारी की सेवा भर न जिसका अर्थ टेढ़ मत पैदा कर गति तीर की अपना पाप को कर लक्ष्य कर दे झूठ को सपना विंध्य रेवा फूल फल बरसात यार गर्मी प्यार प्रिय का कष्ट कारा क्रोध या नरमी देश हो या विदेश तेरा हो कि मेरा हो विशद विस्तार चाहे एक घेरा हो तू जिसे गा दे सदा कल्याण सदा वरदान हो उसकी सदा कल्याण हो उसकी तू जिसे छू दे दिशा कल्याण हो उसकी नाउ इट्स वन ऑफ दोज इट्स अ ब्यूटिफुल अपील टू राइट सिंपली एंड I know that this formed like for many people. I know it did for my father. It was like a charter. That language is first of all spoken. You can't get caught in its literariness too much. You know, good. Very often we find that good language follows the good spoken form. And Bhavani Prasad Mishra was known for this. So he. You know, he was, like Ram said, he was in the middle of a lot of other towering figures, very well-known people who insisted on this kind of language. So Anupamji grew up with this. Said, you know, make it ordinary. You know, kalam apni saad. Now, that's what I was trying to tell you, that not working in English was, usko saadhne mein kitna time lagega? Wo time isi mein lagaye ya kisi aur cheez mein lagaye? Kalam apni saad. और मन की बात बिल्कुल ठीक क्या है एक आध जस्ट अ फ्यू थिंग्स this is obviously, see, the language argument is very complex, but, and that's a separate discussion, he had a wonderful way of approaching the Hindi-English problem in this country. He did have it. And as ever, he had no ready theory for anybody. But if anybody younger wanted a resolution of that problem for himself or herself, he always had practical advice. So.
A few books, amidst them, there is Aaj Bhi Khare Hain Talab. In its original publication, that is Gandhi Peace Foundation publication.
In addition to that, there is this. One copy for our library. That's